Penguin Random House presents Soli Sorabji, Life and Times. Written by Abhinav Chandrachud. Read by Vivek, Bhatia. To Radha, for reminding me that love is an ever-fixed mark that looks on tempests and is never shaken. Chapter 1. The Last Soliloquy. How does a Parsi lawyer, deeply influenced by the principles of Roman Catholicism, fall in love with a Baha'i and go on to become the Attorney General of India for a Hindu nationalist Bhartiya Janata Party, BJP-led coalition government? How does a boy with a broken leg, who studied in a Gujarati medium school and lost his father at the age of 19, go on to mount a heroic defense of the Janata government's decision to dissolve Congress state legislatures in the Supreme Court in 1977? How does a newspaper columnist who admires Nehru, who criticizes the BJP for being obsessed with demolishing mosques and advises them to replace Hindutva with Bharatva or Indianness, get chosen by Prime Minister Vajpayee to represent the government in the Supreme Court in many cases, including the Ayodhya case? How does a lawyer with a humdrum customs and excise law practice, whose grandfather sold horse-drawn carriages in Bombay, become a UN human rights rapporteur and repeatedly defend the fundamental right to free speech and expression in the Supreme Court of India? On a warm summer day in May 2018, I met Soli Sorabji, 1930 to 2021, at his residence at Niti Bagh in New Delhi, to ask him these and scores of other fascinating questions about his life. I was there to convince him to write his autobiography. Equipped with my cell phone, on which I recorded around 6 to 7 hours of my conversations with him, with his permission, over the next several days, I had hoped to put together a preliminary draft of an autobiography for Sorabji, which he could then build upon, edit and publish. In my mind, Sorabji's autobiography would bear the title The Last Soliloquy. In the 2000s, Sorabji used to write a wonderfully witty, humorous and informative column in the Indian Express called Soliloquies. It was a play on the word soliloquy, a monologue by a character on stage who speaks only to the audience and not to any other character in a play. Sorabji was especially fond of the to be or not to be soliloquy in Shakespeare's Hamlet, in which the Prince of Denmark, Sorabji wanted to name his eldest son Hamlet, complains of the pangs of despised love and the law's delay. In his column, Sorabji spoke directly to us, the readers, and not only to the world of courts, judges and lawyers, of which he was a part. In his autobiography, I had hoped that he would speak to us and to posterity once again. Unfortunately, I soon realized that this would not be possible. While Sorabji had an excellent memory for the things that had happened to him in the early stages of his life, his Jesuit teachers at St. Xavier's College, the lawyers and judges he encountered at the Bombay High Court in the 1960s, the poems of Wordsworth and Shakespeare that he had read as a child, his memory was not as sharp for the relatively recent past. When I asked him about the politician L.K. Advani, for instance, he told me about Hotchand Advani instead, a generous lawyer who had a chamber alongside his at the Bombay High Court in the early 1970s. This book is, therefore, a modest replacement for the autobiography that never was. In it, we will see how Sorabji's grandfather, Hormasji, made a fortune selling imported horse-drawn carriages and cars in Bombay. How Sorabji left his Gujarati medium school at the age of 12 and developed a fondness for English literature and Roman Catholicism in Father Bonnet's class at St. Xavier's College, and how he permanently damaged his leg in a motorcycle accident at the age of 18, and lost his father a year later. In the pages of this book, we will read about the awkward relationship Sorabji had with his senior at the Bombay High Court, Karshedji Baba, his first brief in which he failed to get an adjournment, the first case that he ever argued and lost on his own in the Supreme Court for the notorious smuggler Mayor Hans George, how he won a Supreme Court case for the first time, got his own chamber, declined an offer to be a judge, and became a senior advocate. It was Indira Gandhi's phony emergency of 1975 which brought Sorabji into his element and catapulted him into the national arena. Until then, Sorabji had primarily been a customs and excise lawyer. The emergency transformed him into a defender of citizens' rights. He began appearing in many criminal cases for perhaps the first time in his career. Preventive detention cases where he asked the courts to release Indira Gandhi's political prisoners. He mounted a heroic defense of free speech in the Freedom First case in the Bombay High Court and saved many pieces of journalism from the ruthless scissors of the censor. Realizing that copies of anti-government judgments were barred from being published during the emergency, he subversively wrote a book with the only intention that his readers would get to read the pro-free speech judgments that were set out in the book's appendix. He joined the board of directors of the Statesman and fought the government's secret instructions that no government company should advertise in that newspaper. As the additional Solicitor General and later Solicitor General for India with the Janata government from 1977 to 1980, Sorabji played an important part in the Janata government's policy of dismantling Indira Gandhi's emergency-era excesses. He successfully defended the government's decision to impose president's rule on 9 Congress state governments. He helped defend the government's decision to impound the passport of Manika Gandhi, Indira Gandhi's daughter-in-law, so that she could not avoid attending the various judicial commissions that had been set up to investigate her family's alleged misadventures. In the Kissa Kursi Ka case, he called Sanjay Gandhi the personification of untruths to his face in open court. At the same time, Sorabji started appearing in intellectual debates on a unique new medium, television, and was called a scintillating media star by the Times of India. He became an internationally known figure and was invited to attend events in New York and Geneva. As the Attorney General of India with V.P. Singh's National Front government from 1989 to 1990, Sorabji convinced the Supreme Court to partly modify its controversial decision to allow the government to settle the Bhopal gas tragedy case for $470 million by reviving the criminal cases against Union Carbide's management. He set a very high bar for himself, promising that he would never be the mere mouthpiece of the government. Sorabji was never seen as a political partisan. Vajpayee's BJP decided to pick him as the Attorney General despite the fact that he had successfully argued cases which the BJP was ideologically opposed to. Example, a free speech case concerning the famous television show Tamas that the BJP wanted to ban. Though this book is a biography, it is not an obituary or eulogy for Sorabji. In fact, Sorabji was against falsely praising and lying about people after they are no more. Obituary references to the departed soul, he once wrote in the pages of the Indian Express, are the most common form of lying in public. It is unkind to speak ill of a person who is dead and gone, he added. But is it necessary to discover hidden talents and imaginary virtues in the deceased? This book will not try to conceal Sorabji's flaws or whitewash the contentious moments of his career. As the Attorney General of India with the BJP-led coalition government between 1998 and 2004, Sorabji was harshly criticized by the outgoing law minister Ram Jethmalani for, among other things, altering his written opinion in order to allow the government to bail out telecom companies. During this time, Sorabji had an awkward equation with one of his most famous juniors, Harish Salve. In his
book, we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.